reincarnation, the bodiless existence. During the bodiless existence, what happens? This is the period of interval between two bodies, between death and next birth. There are many experiences and impressions of all the previous births. What happens to them? All the experiences and impressions of all previous births remain with the soul in seed form. If you have an empty space and many activities takes place, this place, this space absorbs many subtle vibrations. That is why certain places when you go, you feel elevated. Certain places you do not want to stay. It is that these places absorb the vibrations. The vibrations, because of the activities taking place in temples and churches, absorbs these vibrations. Just as in the cyberspace, all the information remains, but you have to know a technique of surfacing it. So all the experiences and impressions of all previous births remain with the soul in seed form. I said seed form. In order for these to be expressed, we need the body instrument. The instrument as the organs of actions and perception. And as soon as the body, as soon as the soul acquires another body, they become active once again. For example, if your feet is cut, the experience of running, will it disappear? The experience of running will be there. However, without the feet, he can neither run nor stop. Because if he cannot run, how can he stop? But if he acquires the feet once again, all of his experiences and impressions of running and stopping will become active once again, and he will be able to run if he wishes to do so. It is like you have a car and you have been driving it. Now the car is taken from you. You cannot drive the car. You cannot press the accelerator because there is no car, no accelerator, no brakes. Neither he can apply brakes to slow down, nor he can accelerate. But his experiences of car driving remains with him. Or if it is you, the experience remains with you. He is without a car at the moment, but the experiences of driving remains with him in seat form. And the moment you acquire car after some years, Will you have to go to take the driving lessons once again? No. You will sit down, just feel the accelerator and brakes, the steering wheel, and you start driving. You will be able to drive the car as soon as you put your foot on the accelerator and you hold the steering. The liberated soul becomes free of these impressions. There is a difference. The two things. One is those souls that have attained liberation, freedom from birth and death during the lifetime, and those souls that are in interval between the death and new birth. There is a difference. Liberated soul becomes free of these impressions, whereas during the interval between two bodies, the souls become free of the senses, the instrument through which these impressions get activated. In liberation, all experiences and impressions, desires are all destroyed. In both conditions of the soul, there is one similarity, that there is no body. During the interval between death and birth, there is no body. And with the body, the sense organs, the organs of perception and organs of actions are not there. But the difference between, there is a similarity with liberated soul that also does not have the body. But there is one dissimilarity. In liberation, there is neither the body nor the chain of bodily experiences, whether in seed form or not. It is through the awareness all your impressions are dissolved. So during the one who has attained to liberation, there is neither the body nor the chain of bodily experiences. All the experiences that you acquire in life comes through the interaction with the body, whether it is at the physical level or at the level of emotion, and that's where the experiences are gathered. But in liberation, there is neither the body nor the chain of bodily experiences. However, in the interval between birth, though there is no body, there is a long chain of body-related experiences, and all these exist in seed form. And something that is in the seed form can become active once again, once the right environment is provided. So these impressions that are in the seed form become active once again as soon as you acquire the body. So whatever experiences one may have during this interval will be such as one can have without the body. As I have said, these will be the experiences of meditation. But the experiences of meditation are had only by very few persons. Out of millions, only one has the experience of meditation. What experience can the remaining have? Their experiences will be of a dream-like life. In a dream, no sense participates, yet still you are in the dream, it is possible that if a person is in dream and if you keep him in that dream state and cut off his limb, his dream may not be disturbed, but the chances are that his sleep will break. There are two things, dream and the sleep. Sleep will get disturbed, but his dream will continue. If it were possible to cut off his limbs one after the other without breaking his sleep, then his dream would continue undisturbed because none of the limbs of the body are necessary for the existence of the dream. The body is not at all active during the dreams. There is no use of body in the dream state. Without the body, dream experience will remain. In fact, all experiences are dreamlike. All experiences will remain in dream. If someone were to ask you whether you are stationary or in movement during a dream, would you not find it difficult to respond? When you wake up from the dream, you find all along during the dream you were lying in the same place, but you were in a dream. Upon waking, you will find there has been a long, deep happening in the dream, but remember, there was no movement at all in it. You was driving, you was traveling, moving from one place to another at a high speed. The time movement changes during that period. But you were stationary. If you understand properly, you will find you are not even a participant in a dream. In a deep sense, you will only remain a witness. And that is why one can see oneself dying in a dream. One can see one's own body lying dead. In a dream, if you see yourself waking, in a dream you can see yourself walking, then one whom you see walking is a dream phenomenon, but you are a witness to it. You are lying on the bed, but you are seeing yourself walking, running and doing all these things. So this person that you see walking, doing everything, is the dream existence. And the one that who is lying on the bed is a witness. That is why religions have put forth the idea that if a person can view, can envision this world like a dream, he will have the highest religious experience. From this only, the theological concept of calling this world Maya or illusion or a dream has been put forth. The deeper meaning of this is that one can view the world as if in a dream, then one becomes a witness. In a dream, you are always a witness and no one is a participant. In no circumstances you are ever an actor in the dream. Though you may see yourself as an actor, you are always the spectator, the seer, one who is seeing everything, but you are not participating in the dream. How it is? Because you are lying on the bed, you are sleeping, and it is during the sleep you are dreaming that you are walking, you are running, you are going from place to place, you have finally got a seat in the restaurant. So this person that you are seeing doing everything is a dream actor, and you who is lying on the bed is a spectator, the seer, one who is seeing everything. Therefore, all bodily experiences will be dream-like, seed-like. Those whose experiences have created misery for them will see nightmares and dreams of hell. And those whose experiences have brought them happiness will dream of heaven and will be happy in their dreams. But these are all dream-like experiences. Sometimes different types of events may also happen, but these kinds of experiences will differ from person to person. Occasionally it may so happen that souls which are neither stationary nor in a movement can enter other bodies. But to say that the soul will enter is a linguistic fallacy. It would better be to say that somebody may behave in such a way that it will cause soul to enter into it. The world of such souls is not different from ours. That world exists also besides us, close by. We are residing in the same world. Every inch of the space that is here is filled by those souls. A space right here which appears to you to be empty is full of such souls. There are two types of bodies which are in the state of deep receptivity. One is of those that are in great fear. Those who are in great fear cause their souls to contract within their bodies, so much so that they vacate some part of the body completely. If there is a fear in you, certain parts of your body, the consciousness retreats for contract, disappears from those parts of the body, becomes less sensitive. If there is an emotional shock, you may find the person may be sitting like a statue. There is no movement in it. So that means the consciousness has receded from that place, so much so that soul has vacated some parts of your body completely. Some nearby soul drifts into those empty parts like water entering into a hole. At such times, these souls experience things that only a soul with a body can experience. It happened many centuries ago. You would have heard, if you are a Hindu, the name of Shankar, who is known as Adi Shankar. And based on that, he established four establishments in the four corners of India, These are known as Shankaracharya. He was a monk. He used to move from place to place, and he will enter into an argument with the person, and because of his intelligence, he will defeat him. It happened he reached to a place which was the place of a priest known as Mandan. He invited him for a debate, and in that it happened he defeated him in the debate. Debate went on for some time, and ultimately the Mandan, the priest, was defeated. Same time his wife came in, and he said, according to the Hindu religion, wife represents half of the man. So Mandan is not defeated as yet until you defeat me in argument. Shankar was ready and he said, put forth your question. Shankar was a monk, unmarried, because he has taken renunciation, monk. She asked him the question relating to male-female relation, of which Shankar has no experience, because he was a monk. He has assumed the monkhood, so he could not go into the Buddha's method of going into the past lives and past experiences and reliving those. Instead, he chose another method. He looked into through his intuitive vision and he realized a king was dying. So he sat in the middle, and all his 12 disciples sat around him to create a curtain. Because when his soul consciously leaves the body is without the soul. It is the soul that activates the body, gives it an aliveness, and the moment soul is not there, the body is not alive. But if the people around can create an environment through meditation and other techniques, maintain the body can stay for longer time depending on the individual meditative state of the people. So Shankar, he released himself, his soul, from the body, and he entered into the body of the dying king. Remained there for 6 months, experienced the male-female relation, and then when he returned, he went back, the soul went back into the original body, which was being guarded by his disciples sitting in a circular form so nobody can enter. Those 12 disciples formed a circle around his body that was sitting in a meditative posture, so that its warmth is maintained, it is not damaged. So it is the consciousness or the energy field of those 12 disciples were keeping the body active and saving it from getting putrefied. As such, as you know, as soon as the soul releases the body begins to decompose. But it did not happen in that case. So Shankar's soul consciously left the body, entered that of the king, while his physical body was being governed guarded by the disciples. any experience, he came out of that experience. He entered into the debate with Mandan's wife and defeated her. This is one. As such as you are, you have seven bodies, but you are not even completely aware of the physical body. How can you be aware of the other bodies? The physical body, the mental, the magnetic, the electric, the energy, these are the different levels. Another time, I can speak of on these seven bodies once again, but for the present, we have to focus on the along the line that I am speaking. A soul can enter a body when it is in deep prayerful moment. So Shankar was in a state of meditation and his soul entered the other body. In such prayerful moments also the soul contracts. But during fearful moments, only such souls drift in which are the great misery and agony, and these people will see the nightmares. Those are the ones whom we call evil spirits, because a frightened person happened to be an ugly and dirty state of existence, no higher soul can enter him. A fearful person is like a ditch. Only downward moving souls can enter. A prayerful person is like a peak. Only upward moving souls can enter. A prayerful person becomes filled with so much of inner fragrance and so much inner beauty that only the highest souls can take interest in him. And such higher souls will enter only by what we call through invocation, invitation, or prayer. But both these types of experiences by souls are such as could have only been with the body. Thus there is a complete science of invoking the higher souls or gods. These do not descend from some heaven, nor do those whom we call evil spirits come from hell or devil's world. They are all present right here. They coexist along with us, but you do not have the vision to see these. But sometimes in certain moments we feel the presence as if someone is there. And startled, you feel that as if someone has put a hand over your shoulder. But you cannot see this. There remains a feeling. Actually, in the same space, there is a multidimensional existence. For example, this room where we are sitting is full of air. The room where you are sitting is full of air. If someone burns an incense, some aromatic substance, the room will become filled with fragrance. If someone sings a melodious song, the sound waves will also fill the room. But the smoke of the incense will not clash with the wave of the song that is existing. So the fragrance of the incense that you have lit and the song, the sound vibrations can coexist. This room can be filled with music as well as with light, but no light wave will come in conflict with the sound wave, nor will the light wave have to leave to make the room for the entry of the sound wave. In fact, the very space is filled in one dimension by the sound wave, in another by light wave, and in a third dimension it is by the air waves, by the fragrance. Likewise, hundreds of things fill this room in 100 different dimensions. They do not in any way hinder the presence of the other or with one another, nor does anything have to move out of the way for something else to exist. Therefore, all this space is occupied in a multidimensional way. For example, in this place we have a table, but we cannot keep another table in the same place because tables are of the same dimension. But an existence of another dimension will not find the table to be a barrier. A table can exist, a painting on the wall can exist together. All these souls are very near us. Anytime they can be available and they can enter. When the souls enter, then they will have a bodily type of experience. These experiences are such as can be had only through the presence of the body. Another factor that concerns the way in which these souls that enter the living bodies communicate. How does these souls that enter communicate? Communication is possible only between the souls entering the body and souls existing in the body. That is why so far this earth, no spirit, evil or godly, has been able to communicate directly with us, right before our eyes. But it is not true. There has not been any communication. Communication takes place. Information that we have about heaven and earth, heaven and hell, is not something out of the people's imagination. Then different scriptures speak of the state of heaven and hell. It is not imagination. Instead, it has been communicated by the souls through the medium of the body. Thus, in old days, there was a system. For example, with Vedas of Hindus, none of the sages of the Vedas would ever say that he was the writer of such and such a composition of Vedas. There was no copyright issue as it is now. He was not a writer at all. It is not out of humility or modesty that the sages did not claim to be the writer. It is a fact that they had written down was in a sense heard by them. We use in Hindu scriptures a word called mantra drishta. We are only the seers, seers of whatever is written. In fact, whatever they had written down in a sense was heard by them. It is a very clear experience when some soul enters into you and speaks. The experience is very clear. that you know fully well that you are sitting outside while someone else and not you is speaking. You two are the listener and not the speaker. This is not easy to know from outside, but if observed with the proper attention, it is possible. For example, the manner and the style of speech will be different. The tone will be different. The diction and the language will also differ. To the original owner of the body, everything will be crystal clear from inside. If some evil spirit has entered, then the person will perhaps be so much afraid that he will become unconscious. But if a celestial soul has entered, then he will be aware and awakened such as he never was before. Then the situation will be crystal clear to him. So those in whom the evil spirits enter will be very clear about the fact that someone has entered into them, and only such evil spirits leave the body because they become so fearful that they faint and fall unconscious. But those in whom the celestial souls, the higher souls, enter will be able to say at the very moment that what is being spoken is by someone else, not by me. This is the reason that all the sages who have compiled the scriptures, the Vedas, they did not claim any authority on the writing, no copyright act, as it is being done in the present world. Somebody else's words are being used as a copyright, and many different things are happening. Let's look at it. There is one microphone, and two persons are using one microphone. Both these voices will use the same instrument to transmit the voice. One will stop speaking while the other will start. When the sense of the body are used in such a way that it is possible for bodiless souls to communicate, the speaking will happen through the instrument of the vocal cord. It is like the microphone. One person speaks, the other is silent, and then the one who was silent up to now begins to speak, and the other who was speaking up to now becomes silent. It is possible for bodiless souls to communicate. That is how whatever is known to this world about the spirit and about other things, it has been communicated by the spirits. There is no other way to know about these. Just as you know you are capable of connecting to the cyberspace, and all the information that is there you can bring it onto the computer screen, edit it and present it. Something like this happens. For all these, the complete science has been evolved. Once a science is evolved, things become easier to understand. Then these things can be made use of with full understanding. When these kind of events happened in the past, The scientific principles were derived from them. For example, if accidentally or suddenly some celestial soul had entered into someone, then from the study of that happening, certain principles regarding the conditions conducive for such phenomena to happen would be evolved. Then it could be said, if such conditions can be created again, then again the soul will enter. For example, Muslims use loban and benzoin to burn. This is the method of inviting the good souls by creating a specific fragrant environment. Muslims don't light any other incense except loban and benzoin. And it is said, it is their belief that by lighting these, they can invite the good souls' spirit. Hindus also burn incense, and they light a flame that is made out of clarified butter, and these things appear to be ritualistic formalities today. But there was once a time when they had a deep meaning, and the meaning is lost now. There is no one, neither your priest is aware of that, or communicates or explains to you in that way, and these have mere reduced to a ritual. Priest is interested in his cash register, how the cash register is going during the season, because just like the business is seasonal, a priest's business is also seasonal. So he has to make advantage of the, during the Christmas period, you keep your business open for a longer period of time. You make arrangements so that you can have more sales. In the same way, the religious person tries to increase his activities during that period, because he knows very well after this period is over, it will be a dry season as far as the business is concerned. So it has become a mere ritual and the meaning is lost. Hindus will chant a specific mantra which becomes an invocation. It is not necessary that there should be a meaning to that mantra. Ordinarily, there is none. Because mantra with meaning becomes distorted with the passage of time. But meaningless mantras do not become distorted. With a meaningless mantra, nothing extraneous or external can enter with the passage of time. That is why all the mantras that are very deep, they are meaningless. They have no meaning, so nothing can change, and they remain changeless. They are only sounds. There are methods for chanting these sound waves. If there is a specific beat, intensity and rhythm, the soul that is invoked will enter instantaneously. And if the soul for whom the mantras were devised is dissolved into nirvana, another soul with similar purity will enter. This happens. All the religions of the world have certain specific mantras which are sound vibrations. For example, the followers of Mahavir Jain have a Namokar mantra. It is most beautiful, comprehensive. It has 5 lines. The first says, I bow down to those who have destroyed all enemies. Who can destroy the enemies? Who will be the person who have no enemies? One who has reached to the highest level of awareness or understanding, that for him no enemy exists. He is in total harmony with everything that is happening. So first line says, Om Namo Arihantanam Namo Namo. Om Arihantanam Namo. I bow down to those who have destroyed all enemies. The whole mantra is not necessary to be chanted. Instead, the first line is enough to connect to those souls who have destroyed all their enemies. I bow down to those who have destroyed all enemies. The second line says, I bow down to those who have achieved the liberation, the freedom. This is the next category of the awakened ones. One who has conquered all their enemies. The other is those who have acquired liberation. Third, I bow down to those who are the religious preceptors. Who are the religious preceptors? Om Namo Arihantanam. Om Namo. Here is a particular the words that are used. For your understanding, the English meaning is important. I bow down to those who are religious preceptors. The fourth line, I bow down to those who are the priests. Who are the priests? And the last line, which is very important. That is why I said this is one of the most beautiful mantras for chanting. I bow down to all those, irrespective of religious belief or alliance, I bow down to all the religious aspirants. Bow down to everyone who has attained to that state. It has five divisions. On each division, there is an invocation which becomes deeper and deeper. Ordinarily, people chant the entire mantra, but this is not the proper way. Those who desire to contact higher souls should go on repeating only the first part. The remaining four parts need not be repeated. There should be full emphasis only on the first line, because the souls related to that part differ from those related to the other parts. I bow down to those who have destroyed all enemies. This is a different state. The first part of this mantra, Namo Arihantanam. Ari means enemy. Hant means one who has destroyed all enemies. This is prostration to Arihantas. Those who have destroyed all enemies and those who have transcended all their senses. Ari means enemy and Hant means the destroyer. Therefore, it is a particular invocation to a fully enlightened soul who can take only one birth again. One more birth. This one part should be repeated with a special sound and impact. In this invocation, other Jain souls are not included and therefore they cannot be contacted. This word Arihant is a special technical word which is connected with the highest Jain souls. With this mantra, the soul of Jesus Christ cannot be contacted. There is no such desire expressed here. With this mantra, even the Buddha cannot be contacted. This is a technical term. for the invocation of a particular category of giant souls. Like this, in all the five separate parts of this Purnamokar mantra, there is an invocation for five different categories of the souls. The last invocation, Namo Loe Sabhya Sahunam. Namo Loe Sabhya Sahunam is the invocation for all the religious aspirants. It is directed to all aspirants of all religions. It has nothing to do with Jain or any specific group other than Jain. It is very generalized invocation for contact with any religious aspirant without any particular effect. All religions have such mantras through which contacts have been made. This mantra becomes now Shakti mantra and they become highly significant. A mantra is like a name given to a person, such as the name Ram. With the person is being called by Ram, immediately becomes alert. One of the Western philosopher, he says that there is no need of chanting any mantra. I go on chanting my own name and that becomes a mantra for me. So there are also mantras for ordinary spirits. There is an entire science for invoking both ordinary and extraordinary souls. Sometimes it may be possible to contact a particular soul who is invoked because he may not be there due to the lapse of time. But it will always be possible to contact the soul of a similar type with a mantra. Now take the example of Holy Prophet Muhammad. He always said that he is only a paigambar, a messenger, because Muhammad never felt that whatsoever he was experiencing was his own. The voice came to him from above, and that was very clear. His experiences are described by Mohammedans as ilham. Ilham is the word that means revelations. He felt that something entered into him and began speaking. He himself could not believe what was happening. He did not think that anyone else would believe in him. If he were to say that what was spoken to him was spoken by himself, he thought that no one would believe that. That's why when he came out of that state, he spoke to Mohtarma Khadija, am I mad or what? Then she took him to someone and who explained to him. He had never spoken in that way ever before. He was not known to the people to speak in such a way. People did not know that he could tell such things. So he knew that no one would believe such a story. So what he did? He came back home from the place where the revelation took place in a mode of great fear, trying to avoid others and escape being seen. He did not want to reveal immediately what he knew, because then people would not trust him as he did not have any background for such things in his life earlier. For instance, I speak on a weekly basis, whenever there is a meditation session on a certain topic, you are familiar with the language, with the way that happens. You can identify the voice, you can identify the style of speaking in everything. You know, yes, these words can only be spoken by a person by this name. But this has never happened with Holy Prophet. He did not want to reveal immediately what he knew, because then people would not trust him, as he did not have the background for such things in his life earlier. So upon coming home, he told his wife Khadija what had happened. He also told her if she was able to trust him, then he would tell it to someone else, otherwise not, because that which had come to him had come from ever from a different source. Someone had spoken to him and through him. It was not his voice, but when his wife trusted, he began telling others, and that is why it is said she brought the trust onto the Holy Prophet. Hazrat Abu Bakr Siddiq Raziyallahu Ta'ala Anhu brought belief onto him. And a similar incident happened with Moses. The same thing happened. The voice descended upon him. In order for this voice to descend, some great divine spirit must use someone as a medium. Everyone cannot be used as a medium. This capacity and purity to become a vehicle, a medium, is not an ordinary thing. Communication can only be possible if the vehicle is capable and it is available in its purity, otherwise it will have its own distortion. For communication, another body can be used. This type of attempt was made in the recent times by the Theosophical Society, by Leadbeater and Annie Besant, and the experiment was done on Krishnamurti, Jiddu Krishnamurti, but it failed.